All right. Okay, good afternoon to all of you. Right, we shall continue on chapter 7 of the textbook storage. And I think I'll take 2 hours, 2 lectures to cover this. And for this week, you know that the last lecture, we'll have a holiday, right? So I'll just use these 2 hours to cover this chapter. And from next week, Prof. Yap will continue, right? Okay, under this chapter, we have all these objectives. First, we'll be able to differentiate between the storage devices and also storage media, right? Be able to tell the difference between what are the devices and what are the media, right? And then for one particular storage device, hard disk, we'll look at the characteristic that describe the hard disk. We'll look at the terms such as capacity, the platters, the read-write heads, things like, for example, the cylinders, sectors, and tracks. I think we'll all cover in this lecture. Also, we'll discuss the purpose of having the NAS, Network Attached Storage, and also those external and removable hard disk, and also the hard disk controller. But most likely, we'll cover the hard disk controller next week onward. Next lecture, right? Okay, I think I'll move on to talk about first, storage. Under the storage, we'll talk about storage media and storage devices, right? We know that the storage will hold the data, instruction, and information for future use. For a computer, we need to have certain devices that store all this for future use. The meaning is we have to make it non-volatile, right? When you power off, all this information should be still there. And we make use of storage. And sometimes we also call them secondary storage. Then in that case, what is primary storage? Remember that we have the RAM, okay? The memory chips. Those are the primary storage. For the secondary are the hard disk, optical drive, right? Typically, computers store system software and application software on the storage. When the power is off, it's always there. The system software, the OS, the application software will be stored there. So when you power on and when you want to start the computer, the OS will have to be retrieved from hard disk, right, from the storage device and put it into the memory because the processor can only work with memory, okay? They do not work directly with the hard disk. And also, when you want to say start a certain application like web browsers or the word processor, the OS will try to locate the application software. Also from where? From the storage, such as hard disk or even optical drive. From there, they will bring it into the what? Into the primary storage, which is the memory. And from the memory, the CPU will be able to run programs. Okay. Not only that, the storage devices are also needed by what? By the mobile devices, for example, the camera or smartphone. You know all these need to have extra storage, okay? And typically, you need a lot of that. So, because you need to store pictures, you need to store video and audios, music, so on, right? So, you normally make use of storage for mobile devices. And just now we mentioned that for storage, we have storage media and device. First, we have the definition for media. So a storage medium is the physical material onto which a computer keeps all this data, instruction, and information. Whether input, raw input, or output, you need something to keep it for future use. So this is the actual physical material that stores the data. Typical one, you can say that the CD-ROM itself is the media, or a tape drive, the tape itself is the media, right? So next, we talk about what are the typical media. This picture itself shows all the different types that we can see in the market, right? This one itself, we know is the internal hard disk, right? For some of these devices, in fact, you can't separate the media and the drive. Because for hard disk, it's enclosed together. The hard disk, the whole box itself contains the drive the device as well as the media. The media, strictly speaking, are the platters, right? And external hard disk is the same thing. Network attached storage also, all these, you cannot separate the two. But for example, if you look at the, say, the optical disk, you know the disk itself is the media. And there will be a drive, right? The drive that you can load the media and you will be able to access the data on the media, right? So we also have solid state drive, that is the media. And we also have memory cards. You have many of that, different size, different usage, right? So all these are considered media. And things like USB flash drive, the thumb drive, is also considered the media. And things like compact card, I think less often nowadays, right? You normally don't use it. And the cloud storage also is considered a kind of media, but you do not see it yourself. It's virtual to you, right? All right, you have optical disk, you have smart card as well. And also, I think in the next lecture, we'll talk about microframe. Also, very seldom you see one here, right? Typically, you see it in the library. Right, the next characteristic that we normally talk about the storage is the capacity, right? It is the number of bytes that the storage media can hold, right? The vendor or the manufacturer will use this one to describe how big is the storage size. Okay, used by manufacturer to tell you, are you going to buy a 1 gig or 100 gigs hard disk or 1 gig memory card, right? So I mentioned, I think in the previous lecture, typically we use kilobyte, megabyte, gigabyte, and terabyte. Maybe the first four are important because we use it quite often. And when we talk about these four terms, we normally refer, and at least for this course, but we will refer to the exact number. We do not go to approximation, right? Typically, if you read on the newspaper, they might just quote 10 to the power, right? So for kilobyte, we do not talk about 1,000. We talk about 1024. 2 to the power of 10. That's 1024, right? And then for megabyte, we talk about this 2 to the power of 20. Giga is 2 to the power of 30. So be able to find out the exact quantity because we talk about digital lifestyle, right? So digital computation is needed. Alright, so this will be the common terms used for, I think kilobytes nowadays, not so common. But when you talk about megabyte, yes, there are still some devices. We're talking about megabyte. Gigabyte basically is for what? For thumb drive, for memory card. And terabytes is nowadays for hard disk, right? You get a desktop hard disk, external hard disk of one TB, right? Okay, next we talk about the term storage device. Just now we talk about media, right? So now we talk about definition of storage device. It is the computer hardware that first record item into the storage media. Record means you have to write data or information onto the media, right? And retrieve means we are going to read it from the same thing from the media, right? So we have both directions, right? Basically, it's bidirectional. So reading is the process of transferring the item from the storage medium to the memory. When you transfer, it has to be from somewhere to somewhere, right? So from storage media to the internal memory. So basically, you can think of it as an input process, okay? And when you come to writing, that means the process of what? Transferring the item in the opposite direction from memory to the external media, right? So that is considered an output operation. So you can really think of that as input-output device, but typically we do not classify the storage device as a kind of in-out device, okay? Because we have already know that this is a storage device, okay? We do not call the storage device an in-out device. Alright, also for storage, we talk about the speed, how fast can the storage device operate. So there are two important terms. One is the access time, okay, and the other one is the transfer rate. Based on these two terms, we will be able to rank them accordingly, which one is fastest, which one is slowest, okay. We will be able to compare their performance. For the access time itself, we will measure the amount of time that it takes the storage device to locate a certain data item on the media itself. And if we also use the access time to describe memory before, right? It says the time required to deliver an item from memory to CPU, right? So refer to primary storage and secondary. For primary, which is the memory, we talk about how to move one item from the memory to CPU, right? And for the storage device, we are talking about to locate a certain byte or certain block of data on the media itself, right? So with this definition, we can rank them according to the faster and the slowest. Of course, the fastest will be from the memory. Memory are considered primary storage, and typically we use DRAM or SRAM. Remember the SRAM for cache and DRAM for the rest. So here it also highlighted the what are the things being stored there. It said for memory, typically for those instruction or data waiting to be processed, right, ready inside the memory. And also for the secondary storage or the so-called storage, we talk about hard disk, memory card, optical disk, and tape. All these will be for some other purpose. For example, hard disk, you store the operating system, you store the application software for future use, right? When you power off, all these are still there. It will be kept forever. And for memory card, also the same thing for more mobile usage. Okay, in terms of access time, you can see that for memory, we are talking about nanosecond, 10 to the power of minus 9. Right, that is the kind of access time. As for the other end, when you talk about optical disk and tape drive, the access time is in terms of millisecond, or 10 to the minus 3 second. So you can see there's a kind of 10 to the power of 6 order, right? So that can see the which one. This can be 10 to the power of 6 times faster comparing the memory and the optical disk. Right, for the other terms to use to describe the performance is the transfer rate. Typically, we call it the speed of data transfer. And could be KBPS, MBPS, or GBPS. Kilobyte per second, megabyte per second, and gigabyte per second. Right. So the big capital B here stands for bytes. Not there will be sometimes quoted as small b. Small b is for bit. For this one is a capital B is for bytes. Remember, one byte equal to 8 bits. So as you can see that when we list them according to the transfer rate, then the memory will have the faster transfer rate. And also for the optical drive, tape drive, it is the slower. It talk about kilobyte per second or megabyte per second, whereas over this side you are talking about gigabyte per second, right? We'll zoom into a particular types of storage device, that is the hard disk. We'll spend more time on this because this is still one of the important storage device. Okay, and this device was invented long ago, 1955, by IBM, right? And basically, it's a kind of mechanical non-volatile data storage. Be able to say non-volatile because when you power off, the data or information are all inside. You will always be there because we make use of magnetic effect, right? Whatever things stored on the surface of the platters are using magnetic. Okay, the platters are coated with iron oxide. That is magnetic. So you can always have the same information stored there even without the power, right? And the read-write heads will actually float. There will be read-write heads on the surface, but it's not touching the surface. And why it can float on the surface is because the platters are spinning at very high speed. When it spins, there will be a small cushion of air that leaves the head above the surface. And the read-write head will be able to read from the surface. And there are all different form factors. Initially, all are gigantic, right? But nowadays, you talk about portable hard disk, talking about 1-inch to 1.7-inch micro drive. Or 1.8 typically for what? For your notebook. And 2.5 also for laptop. 3.5 basically are external hard disk, right? Or for desktop. Just to show you some picture about the internal of the hard disk. You can, if you really open up, of course you don't have the tools to do so. Typically if you work for a hard disk company, you see the internal of the hard disk. And on the right hand side here is a hard drive platters. If you count here, I think there are some 10 pieces. So that means there are all together 20 surfaces, right, for recording. And for each surface, for each side of the platter, it has to, you have to have one rewrite head. So for whatever you see here is 1, 2, 3, 4, or maybe four will have 8 heads, right, rewrite heads. Here is another picture that you see a so-called head stack assembly. And you can see they are all together so many. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Right, there are 8 of them. And for this case, if you take a close look, you have 2 platters, and because there are four surfaces, so you need to have 4 heads. For each side, you need to have 1 rewrite head to rewrite data, right? Okay, next we move on to about the method of recording. The method of recording affects the density, how many bit per inch that it can record on the surface, right? So it says currently the hard disk can store data using 2 methods. One is longitudinal, means horizontal, right? You can see the top one here, and the other one is called perpendicular recording. So let's take a look at the horizontal recording. You can see that for, when you think about magnetic effect, magnet will have 2 poles, right? There's north and south. So if you think of every bit is a magnet, so you should have a north and south. If you put it onto the surface horizontally, then we call it a horizontal recording. And in this case, the density is not high enough. As compared to the so-called perpendicular, the newer hard disk, they use perpendicular, that means they put the single bit as vertical, north-south pole pointing up and down, right? So you can see that in this case, they will pack more bits per inch. So in terms of the storage, with the same size, same number of inches, in terms of diameter, they will be able to pack more bits onto the same surface. So this, when we talk about this recording method, we refer to magnetic particle alignment with respect to the surface, whether we are putting them horizontally or putting them vertically, right? So up to how big difference? 10 times, okay? Comparing the so-called perpendicular methods with the horizontal methods, the perpendicular can record 10 times more data onto the same area. Just to give you one example here, this one was released in 2010. It's a Seagate hard disk. And this hard disk itself has 2 gigabyte content, and also, I think it should be, it should be 2 tera, you know, it's just 2 gigabyte, it's a very small hard disk. However, it makes use of what? The perpendicular recording, okay, as you can see that. But it says, within 5 years, the hard disk will likely to be 5, 10 terabyte or 10 terabyte, okay. Just now we talk about for hard disk, there will be more characteristics that we need to talk about. This picture, this slide here show you all those things that are used to describe a hard disk. First, we talk about capacity, right? Manufacturer will tell you this is 1 gigabyte, 10 gigabyte, or 1 terabyte, right? And within the hard disk, how many platters, how many pieces of that material inside, how many rewrite heads, and also how many cylinders, and sectors and tracks, and also what is the spinning speed RPM, the revolution per minute, and also the transfer rate, just now we mentioned, in terms of megabyte per second, kilobyte per second, and also the access time. These last two here will determine the what, the performance of the hard disk. We'll go into it, right? Typically, when the vendor sell you a hard disk, if you go into the data book or data sheets, they will quote something like this, right? Say, for example, the advertised capacity is 500 gigabyte for this case. However, when you use a PC and you right-click and show the detail of that hard disk, C drive or D drive, you might see that it is smaller. Okay, that is so-called the formatted, the actual disk capacity. Whatever code here, usually they use base 10, okay? That means they are not using binary. So there will be some difference there also. Remember, the layman terms usually based on 10 to the power, right? But the actual storage is based on 2 to the power. So the two will have certain difference. Not only that, the formatted space will be slight. The formatting itself take away certain storage, okay? So whatever you see here, you say you buy a 500 gig drive, if you go in and check, the actual storage space is usually smaller, right? And they'll tell you how many platters are inside, say for example 4, right? And then how many rewrite heads. If you have 4, I think you definitely have 8 times 2. These three information are basically the physical data, right? Physical characteristic. Whereas they will also tell you the physical, in terms of performance, 8.5 milliseconds in terms of access time. Also the transfer rate, like 300 megabyte per second. And also the RPM, revolution per minute, 7,200. And they will also give you the total number of sectors per drive. Okay, this is the amount. With this amount, if you use it to multiply by 512 byte per sector, these two multiplied together will give you the actual storage capacity. Right. So this is how you get it. Okay, that's it. What are the things that determine the capacity? First, whether you get a horizontal recording or vertical recording, because the density count, right? And also, how many platters you have inside the device, and also depend on the material used for the coating for the surface. That will decide how many bit per inch that they can record. So the term used, we normally say we format the hard disk. A hard disk will not be able to be used with the PC or Mac unless it's formatted, right? It said formatting is a process of what? Dividing the hard disk into tracks and sectors. Right, under the surface is originally empty, right, just with the magnetic material coated on it. But you need to do a formatting to form the tracks and sectors so that the OS can store and also be able to locate the data or information or instruction onto it, right? So next we will talk about, since we talk about formatting, we need to know the tracks and the sectors. If you look at this diagram here, we will look at the tracks. Okay, what are the tracks? It says it's a very narrow recording band. Okay, so you can see that the blue circle here is considered a track, very tiny width, and is a circle. It's forming a circle that is considered one track. Okay, it says there are many tracks on this surface itself, concentric, based on the same center, right? And this will form the full circle on a disk, considered one track, right? And in terms of density, we are talking about greater than 2,000 TPI. T stands for track. Track. There are 2,000 tracks per inch, right? That I think that is still considered low end. With the new hard drive, I think having a better quality of the recording material, it can go higher than that. Okay? But this 2,000 TPI, just imagine 1 inch. They will be able to pack in 2,000 tracks. And how about the sector? Okay, since we have one full circle, it's one track. Okay, and talk about the, you still need to subdivide into a small portion for organizing the track. So we divide them into sectors. Okay, a typical number will be 18 sectors per track. Sector is this small portion here we consider a sector, right? You divide one full circle into equal length pieces is considered the sector. And one common storage number is for every sector you store about 512 bytes. You look at the number, usually 2 to the power, right? 512 is 2 to the power of 9, right? That is the number of bytes per sector, quite a typical one. And for many OS, like IBM PC, typically the sectors are not the smaller unit that it work with. They will try to put a number of sectors into one cluster and be able to deal with a cluster Each cluster is about 2 to 8 sectors. Okay, that means they are not working with a single sector. Usually they work with the clusters. And during the formatting process, it is not just doing the track, forming the tracks and sectors. Sometimes the recording material onto the surface is malfunction, damage, or certain bad spot. They will try to mark that bad spot, bad sector, as not recordable, right? Not usable. So when you say, they will mark out the bad sector, so that when the user using it, that particular sector will not be written with any data. They will avoid that particular bad sector. So furthermore, the number of the total storage should be much smaller because you have bad sectors inside there, right? Okay, just now I mentioned that this is additional slide. The older generation, maybe I go back to that slide first. Right, in the older technology, the number of the sector with the length itself is constant. That means no matter whether you are the outer circle or inner circle, you can see that the sector in the inner circle are much shorter, right? Based on the geometry, you know that the outer circles, outer tracks, are having longer length per sector. This is not optimum because we are talking about the bit per inch, right? So the outer, because it's longer, should be able to pack in more bits. However, it's not done this way. They have a constant number of sector per track. So like for example, 18 sector per track. That is not efficient. So with the new hard disk, just now I mentioned this slide here, as you can see that in order to pack in more, they use a so-called variable sector per track. That means they will divide the tracks. There are so many, right? So many concentric tracks. They divide them into zones. At least for this diagram here, you can see there are the blue zone, the light blue, the green and yellow and red, right? As you can see that the outermost zone, they will have more sectors. For each partition here is considered one sector. There are more sectors on the outer zone. There are less in the, like for example, the red zones, they will have less sector per track. In this case, all the sectors on this surface will have about equal length. So they can pack more data onto the surface, right? This is the way they do it. And the table here indicates that for zone 0, the track in this, you can see that the zone itself is having the equal number of tracks. However, the sector per track for zone 0 is 232 sector per track. If you go all the way to zone 5, it's much less, 205 sector per track. And because of that, because when you turn the spindle, the drive is driving at a constant revolution per minute, right? So the linear speed at the outermost will be higher. That means the head moving across a surface will have a higher relative speed, right? So that's why the data transfer rate will be higher when the head is on the outer zone. When the head moves into the inner zone, the so-called data transfer rate will be lower, as you can see from this table, right? So there are two old drive, historical drive, using a constant so-called number of sector per track. The new, more advanced hard disks are using so-called variable sector per track. Another term that they like to use is the surrender, right? What is the surrender? It says it's a vertical section of track through all platters. We know that there are many platters in a drive. And each platter itself, there will be two surfaces, right? And that means there will be one track on top and one track below, right? So if you take a vertical cross section, at least for this particular drive having two platters, there will be four surfaces, right? So there will be two tracks based on the same vertical cross section. We have two tracks on one platter, another two tracks on the bottom platter, right? So all together, this forms a cylinder. That means this cylinder will have four tracks, okay? The head will always move across and access a cylinder of tracks at one time. Maybe I'll show you another one to to see really where is the virtual surrender, right? I have this additional pictures, right? If you look at this drive, we have all the platters here. At least I show 1, 2, 3 here, right? Actually, there are many more. For each surface, we will have a track, right? So when the head assembly that move, it will move all together, in or out, into the center or out to the circumference, right? So can see that the dotted line here. If I'm trying to assess this particular track itself, the head will be assessing the same tracks across all platters, all surfaces, right? And if you look at the dotted line here, you can see that basically it forms a cylinder, right? A cylinder with all the tracks at the same location, right? So this is how we look at why we call it a cylinder, right? And typically the drive is spinning at very, very high speed, talking about 5,400 RPM. RPM stands for revolution per minute, and up to 15,000 RPM. Just can't imagine, the speed is very, very fast. I think your motor car cannot drive at that. The engine will break down, right? Typically when you have an idling engine, it's how many RPM? About 2,000, okay? So when you drive on the highway, typically it's about 3,000 RPM. So if you drive up to 7,000, I think the engine will break, but for hard disk it's okay, right? So it can go up to 15,000 RPM. Next, we look at how a hard disk works. There are four steps here. Step number one, inside the hard disk, typically they will have a small controller board, the PCB, circuit board. On that circuit board, they will have one processor, a hard disk controller, with some memory inside, like cache memory, also some logic chips. And that will form the controller for this hard disk to interface to the PC, right? External world, right? Within this one, we will have the circuit board that control the movement of what? The head actuator. This, can see this head assembly having as many as two times how many each surface will have one head, right? And this thing is mounted together, head assembly. And the head assembly is controlled by so-called the head actuator. The head actuator is controlled by this circuit board. So when they move together. No matter how many heads, okay, it will move together. And also the circuit board will control a small motor at the middle. This is normally a DC motor, direct current motor, and we call it a spindle motor, right? They have to make sure that the motor revolve at constant speed. If the speed not stable, then the data will not be able to read out properly, right? So they have to have this circuit board to control the spinning speed to keep it constant. And how fast? In terms of few thousand of RPM, right? Step number two, the small motor spin the platters while the computer, when you power on the computer's hard disk is power up as well, and the spinner motor will just turn this all the platters together at a certain RPM, right? Just how I mentioned, 5400 RPM to 15,000 RPM. Step number three, then, when the software needs to get a piece of data, first, it has to know where is the current location of the head, where does it stay, and you try to find out where is the target. From the original position until the target location, they will have to compute how much movement the head has to move across the surface. So with that computation, then step number four, the head actuator will actually position the head exactly above that particular track to locate for the piece of information and read it out, get the head, rewrite head to read out the data from there. So you can see all these are on the fly, right? Otherwise, it is not that useful. Another term, important term you don't like to hear about, if you happen to plug in a hard disk and you see that there's clinking sound inside, you know it's almost, after a while we cannot find the data, you know the hard disk is gone, right? Say for example, if you have a hard disk, portable hard disk, you are not careful enough, you drop it onto the floor, I can guarantee you that more than 50% you will not be able to use it anymore, right? So be careful for your portable hard disk, because internally they are all mechanical components, right? They are moving parts. So the moment you drop the height itself, I think it's important. Even with a small height, I think it will cause some error, right? So this term is called head crash, right? It said that this occur when the rewrite head touch the surface, right? Typically, when it's running, it will never touch the surface. And the reason why it doesn't touch the surface is because when the battery is spinning at that high speed, and under the so-called aerodynamic, there will be a small layer of what you call it, air, that force it. There will be a small flow of air that float the head above. And the gap here is talking about 50 micron. I think the word here is 2 billion of an inch. I compute is about 50 micron. And if you compare the size of, say, a dust particle or a smoke particle, it is just so tiny that anything fall inside the interior of the hard disk will cause it to crash. Of course, when you drop it, there will be certain things drop inside that cause it to touch the surface, right? And for most of the hard disks, when they get manufactured in the factory, they will have a so-called class 10 or class 100 environment. When they say class 10, means they only have 10 particles per million. They filter the air until so clean that there will not be big particles going into the enclosure. Because if you have a small dirt inside, the hard disk will crash one day or the other. Okay? So basically, it's a very clean environment before they pack it. That's why nobody repair the hard disk in the open air. Okay? Any particle go inside, the hard disk will crash. Beside the hard disk, there's another technology that I want to talk about. It's a older technology, which is a floppy disk. Some of you might not have seen one nowadays, right? Anyway, it's good to know, because for this one, it is easier to compute the, based on the parameters, we'll be able to compute the size, the storage capacity for this floppy disk. One common one is the so-called 3.5 inch, originally came out with Sony. Sony produced this 3.5 inch, and which company used it first? Apple. Apple used it for the Macintosh, and I think a few days ago they just celebrate 30 years anniversary, right? So these are probably this 3.5 inch from Sony must be about the same 30 years anniversary, right? However, look at the components of these floppy disk. You have a so-called plastic cell, right, to protect the internal, to make it rigid. And also, in order to show the read-write head, to let the read-write head access the surface, you have a small window called a shutter. When it's external, when you remove it from the drive, the shutter will close up, okay, so that the dust will not go in. But when you insert this floppy into the drive, the shutter window will open so that the rewrite head can position above the window. And at the middle, there will be a metal hub so that it can be engaged with the spinner motor so that it turns at a constant speed. And also, there will be one, same thing like it's a piece of material with magnetic coating that can do data recording, right? And also, both sides they will have a one white liner, right, to protect the surface. Because this whole this piece will be spinning within the jacket, the plastic enclosure. So you rub against this plastic enclosure, and it might damage the surface. So what we need to do is having this liner to protect it. So how do you compute this particular floppy disk? Based on the parameters given in the data book, you quote the capacity is 1.44 megabyte. Very, very small, right? That's why it never appear anymore, right? one small thumb drive will be hundreds or thousands of floppy, right? However, if you born 10 years younger, I think you still use this one quite common, right? Capacity is 1.44 megabyte, and it has two sides. And how many tracks per side? 80 tracks. How many sectors per track? This also use a constant. Just now we mentioned about variable, right? This is a constant number of sector, a fixed number of sector per track, 18. So we all this number, if you multiply together, you get sector per disk 2880. So with this, how do we know it's 1.44 megabytes? Because every sector also a fixed number of bytes. Every sector is 512 bytes. With 512 multiplied by 2880, you get 1474560. And you round it up, it is called a 1.44 megabyte floppy disk. A 3.5 inch, typically on the surface, they will label it as 1.44, okay? There's another version called 0.7 only, half the density. So how you compute? Just multiply all the parameters, you get it, okay? You need to know that there are two surfaces, two sides. And per side, how many tracks is also fixed. And then they also give you the how many sector per track. And you just multiply them together, you get the figures. Right. We'll next talk about a hard disk controller. In order for all these devices to talk to the CPU, you need to have a controller. It says this controller consists of what? Very special purpose, a component, and also other electronic that control the transfer of data, information or instruction. Anything you need to move out from the hard disk, the media itself, you need to always go through this controller, right? And it is an interface between the hard disk and the system. I will show you one diagram here. Okay, if you buy a PC, typically when you need to add hard disk to this system, you need to have a so-called hard disk interface, or so-called disk controller. This card itself is a disk controller, right? Just now we mentioned that there is a controller, something like a processor. That is called a hard disk controller. There are some RAM chips, memory chips for transferring of data, recording the data. And over at one side, there will be this so-called PCI interface. PCI is a bus, okay? From all the PC, there will be a PCI bus. That's considered a high-speed bus. The bus is for this card to interface with, to talk to the other device within the PC, also to talk to the CPU, right? So this edge will be a PCI connecting to the system bus. Over the other side, you have two other connectors. These two connectors varies, depend on what kind of cards you have. Say for example, if you are using the EIDE hard disk, this card itself will give you two edge connector that is connecting to the actual hard disk. They will use a big ribbon cable for you to connect to the drive. So you can see that the hard disk making use of this interface card to talk to, going to the PCI bus and connect to your PC. Right. Another example here is so-called a SATA card. Later we'll talk about that. Also, they will have all the, on one side there will be a SATA port to connect to SATA hard disk. And over this end, still the so-called the PCI connection. This diagram I have shown in the previous lecture basically is to show you where is the PCI. Right. Remember that for processor to talk to outside world, it has to go through a chipset, so-called the interface controller, and that will come out with a PCI bus and also AGB bus. All these will go to, on the motherboard, they will give you the so-called expansion slot. Remember the expansion slot and expansion card. Your hard disk interface card will go into one of the PCI bus connector, right? So go into the expansion bus. Just now, that particular card, remember? This card, we have a PCB edge connector. that will go into the one of the slot here. So once it plugged into here, you'll be able to go through this chipset to talk to the CPU, also to talk to the memory chip. If you need to transfer data or instruction or information from the hard disk, you go through this chipset and go into the memory, right? So this is how it works. So there are many different types of interface. We have SATA, we have EIDE, SCSI, and SAS. We will talk about all this. Okay, I think we will stop here for, we will continue next lecture.